Hi everyone, my name is Claire Tomlin. I'm a professor of electrical engineering and computer sciences at Berkeley, and this is module 26 in a series that we're recording to support the course EECS 221A Linear System Theory at Berkeley. This module is called the Second Representation Theorem. And so if you think back, or if you've seen the earlier modules, one of the first things that we did in our linear algebra modules was to show through a constructive proof that any linear map between finite dimensional vector spaces can be represented by matrix multiplication. Okay, so the first representation theorem, actually we just called it the fundamental theorem, or we called it the representation theorem, but now that we have a second one, we'll call it the first representation theorem, is that any linear map A, so A is linear, and it's going between finite dimensional vector spaces, so here U and V are finite dimensional, meaning they have a finite dimensional basis. It can be represented by matrix multiplication. So A can be represented by a matrix A, which is going to depend on the bases that you choose for the domain and the codomain respectively. Okay, first representation theorem. And we also had a theorem for constructive theorem for this. So we not only showed that it can be represented by a matrix, but we actually constructed what that matrix is based on the bases chosen for U and V. So if we think about a basis here as the UJs and a basis over here as the VIs, then that first representation theorem says the following, that where the jth column of the matrix A is A of UJ written with respect to the VIs, with respect to the basis over in the codomain, the VIs. Okay, so you've got your two bases. You look at A operating on each of the basis elements in the domain. So for the first column of A, you take A of U1, and then you figure out what the coefficients are of A of U1 when you're writing that with respect to the basis over in the codomain. And that gives those coordinates, give you the first column of the matrix A, et cetera. Okay, so we have a representation theorem. This is very important, and we've gone through that before. Okay, so what is the second representation theorem? So now that we're a little adept from our previous module in thinking about A invariant subspaces and direct sums, we can use that to say a little bit more about the form of this matrix A when we have certain properties of the overall spaces. Okay, so the second representation theorem, it says the following. Suppose you had a vector space V, which was the direct sum of two subspaces, M1 and M2. So let's suppose that V has dimension N, and let's suppose that M1 has dimension K, and then M2 has dimension N minus K. So this is a finite dimensional vector space. If M1 is A invariant, so let's suppose M1 is A invariant, then the matrix A has a representation which is as follows. Then A has a representation, meaning a basis can be chosen for the space V such that A has a representation which looks like the following. Okay, so I'm going to write it in terms of these block matrices, A11, A12, A22, and this matrix here is 0. And the dimensions of these blocks are as follows. So A11 is a K dimensional, so it's K columns and K rows. So A12 has K rows, and it has N minus K columns. And then A22 is N minus K by n minus k. And then this 0 is going to be an n minus k row by k column matrix. So basically, the important thing of this theorem is that if M1 is A invariant, then the matrix A can be represented by a matrix which has a 0 block down here. Okay, so why is that true? When we're proving the second representation theorem, we're saying in general, so this is, these can be just general non-zero elements, but why is this matrix down here? Why can you construct an A such that there's a 0 matrix down here? And basically, we can construct it, we can prove this by constructing a basis for M1 and M2, and then using the first representation theorem to show why these elements down here are all going to be 0. And that's a fairly straightforward proof, given that we're comfortable with the first representation theorem. So we can just think about the proof up here. Okay, so let's construct a basis for M1 and for M2. So I'll use B to represent the basis. B1 up to BK is a basis for M1. And then we'll use BK plus 1 up to BN is a basis for M2. Okay, so now let's see what happens. If we have a vector x in M1, then an M1 is an A invariant subspace. Well, first of all, we know that we can write out x as a linear combination, so it's of the basis elements in M1. So let's write it as the summation from I equals 1 up to k of ci bi. And since AX1, or AX, also belongs in M1, because M1 is A invariant, then AX can be written as a linear combination of, let's call them eta basis vectors in M1. Okay, so because M1 is A invariant, we know that AX also belongs to M1, so it can be written as a linear combination of the basis elements. So basically, this property holds for, you know, if we chose X to be any of the basis vectors in M1, so B1 is in M1, so it can be written, I mean, it's just a combination of itself, it's a basis vector, but in particular, AB1 also belongs in M1 because M1 is A invariant. So AB1 can be written as a linear combination of the basis vectors in M1 only. Okay, so if we think about AB1, that's going to be eta 1 B1 plus eta 2 B2 up to eta k BK. And then the coefficients of all of the basis vectors that are in V but not in M1, so they're in M2, the coefficients of those are just going to be 0. 0 BK plus 1 plus 0 BN. And that holds for all of the basis vectors in M1. So AB2 will have coefficients for, will have non-zero coefficients or possibly non-zero coefficients for the first k terms, and then the remaining terms will all be 0 because that vector is also in M1, et cetera. And so if we think about the first representation theorem, the first column of the matrix A is A of B1 written with respect to the basis B1 up to Bn. So these terms are going to be 0. That's the zeros here. AB2, these terms will be 0. So you end up with a 0 matrix here just because of those zeros there. And if you do that for all of the ABKs, that spans over the first K columns. Okay, so second representation theorem. If you can break a space down into a direct sum, one of them is A invariant, then you get a matrix representation as follows. Okay, so this part here is relative to the space M1. If both of them are A invariant, so if both M1 and M2 are A invariant, then let's write it as M. Let's actually just edit this. So now M2 is A invariant. Then A has a representation where not only do we have a zero here, but we end up with a zero over here too. And the proof is exactly the same as the one we've just done. If M2 is A invariant, then A of BK plus 1 can be written only in terms of a linear combination of these basis vectors, and the coordinates for the basis vectors, which are from M1, are all zeros. Okay, so you end up with zeros up here. Okay, so we have a kind of neat result which tells us about what the matrix representation of a linear map or a matrix itself can be in the case in which the vector space can be broken down into the direct sum of A invariant subspaces. Okay, good. So now that we've got that under our belt, we can move on and we can start talking about Jordan form, which we're going to do in the next module. Thanks very much.